Good morning.
Good morning.
Before we start this morning, I'm going to take a moment and tell you a little bit about our weekend, which started on Thursday. I think it's the second week that Rick has had working Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. We went to the hospital. It was supposed to be a two-hour procedure. Well, not, but a total of two-hour time. And we were in the hospital for 5 hours. The procedure went really fast. It took about half the time they expected. But other than being in pain for 2 days in his lower back, everything went as expected. And in about 2 weeks, we will have the results for that. Friday morning, before we got out of bed, we got the call from our son saying that the water had broke. They were on their way to the hospital. About 6:30 in the evening, we had gone to Jamie's so that we could be there for Joseph's swim meet. We got a text saying they're prepping her for C-section. About 8 o'clock, we got a picture of our grandson on the scales. 9 pounds, 12 ounces. We found out the next day that the cord had been wrapped around his neck and that he was sunny side up. So if she had progressed enough for the birth, it would have been bad. So we're very glad that the doctors said now was the time for a C-section. Before we got out of bed on Saturday morning, we got a call from Rick's brother saying that his mother had passed away. She'd gotten up like normal in the morning. Either on her way to the bathroom or in the bathroom, she became unresponsive, and she was gone. So we're very glad that that process was an easy process. The funeral is Saturday in northern Maine, so we'll be missing the cookie walk. We need people to step in to cover the roles that we would normally do. It could be a tense situation. The family hasn't been together, usually because of her, but there's some tensions because of that that could come out. And so, if you remember, if God lays it on your heart, just whisper a prayer that all will be going well. And this morning, as I tried to read, I can't get through a sentence and know what it's saying, so I'll do my best. And I think that even if you can't track with me, you will still be here with together, and we'll get through this service. Advent is a season of joy. Sometimes we have tears of joy. We celebrate the coming of the Christ child with parties and gifts, special decorations and new clothes. We gather with family and friends for special events. We honor long-held traditions. We also reach out to those whose joy is dimmed in this season. Today we light the third candle, the candle of joy for Christ. Our joy is coming. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Let us bask in the radiance of Christ's presence as we light the candle of joy.
Thank you. will never be found in tinsel or colored lights, and
even less in the excesses of the season. True joy is found in you and in you alone. Thank you for the gift of joy incarnate. Thank you for the Spirit who manifests your joy in our hearts all year long. Come, Lord Jesus, bring us the gift of your joy and your life. In Christ's name we pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Psalm 146. But joyful are those who have the God of Israel as their helper, whose hope is in the Lord their God.
He made heaven and earth, the sea and everything in them. He keeps every promise forever.
He gives justice to the oppressed and food to the hungry. The Lord frees the prisoners. The Lord protects the foreigner among us. He cares for the orphans and widows, but he frustrates the plans of the wicked.
The Lord will reign forever. He will be your God over Jerusalem throughout the generations.
Today is the last day to give a gift for this current round of Heifer International, helping to empower women in poorer countries. The cookie decorating on Wednesday is going to start at noon. How many of you plan to be here for noon o'clock? Okay. How many plan to be here after 1 o'clock? Okay. There are still envelopes for Christmas memorials on the narthex table. The cookie walk is Saturday. Rick and I will not be here, as I said, but if you are not going to be here and you would like to buy a raffle ticket for the quilt, the drawing will be Saturday morning during the cookie walk. So if you would like to buy it, today is the last chance. Next Sunday, Jim will be taking the service that I printed last Wednesday for next Sunday, not realizing I was printing the wrong one. So I really appreciate him doing that. And you come out and support him too. This year we have early announcement on the Christian Unity prayer service. It will be on January 22nd at the Methodist Church, and their new pastor will be the one preaching that day. Paul Rawcliffe, who used to attend here, until nursing home made it impossible. Well, he no longer had a ride from the nursing home because he changed nursing homes. Has just come for a rehabilitation center back home. His cell phone number is 508-241-8219, and he would appreciate calls.
Tomorrow?
Okay. Also, Agnes McLaughlin, I stopped to see her for home communion, and she was in Miriam Hospital. She's supposed to be home by today, so I will check to see if they thought that she would go to Grace Barker when she came back from the hospital. Matthew 11:4, the blind see, the lame walk. I told Rick this morning his mother is now not lame. The lepers are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is being preached to the poor. And tell him God blesses those who do not turn away because of me. If our ushers would come forward and receive our morning tithes and offerings. You sent us your messenger, John the Baptist, to prepare our hearts and souls for the coming of Christ. Multiply these gifts to echo his message of your greatness and glory. Open our ears to the needs of your people shrouded in depression and despair. Use our voices to tell your stories and to lead others into the community of Christian fellowship. Let our actions of faithful giving being a beacon of our complete devotion to your guidance in our lives. We pray to your glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us sing together, What Child Is This?
From the book of Isaiah, chapter 35, verses 1 through 10. Even the wilderness and desert will be glad in those days. The wasteland will rejoice and blossom with spring crocuses. Yes, there will be an abundance of flowers and singing and joy. The deserts will become as green as the mountains of Lebanon, as lovely as Mount Carmel or the plain of Sharon. There the Lord will display his glory, the splendor of our God. With this news, strengthen those who have tired hands and encourage those who have weak knees. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong and do not fear, for your God is coming to destroy your enemies. He is coming to save you. And when he comes, he will open the eyes of the blind and unplug the ears of the deaf. The lame will leap like a deer, and those who cannot speak will sing for joy. Springs will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams will water the wasteland. The parched ground will become a pool, and the springs of water will satisfy the thirsty land. Marsh grass and reeds and rushes will flourish where desert jackals once lived. And a great road will go through that once deserted land. It will be named for the highway of holiness. Evil-minded people will never travel on it. It will be only for those who walk in God's ways. Fools will never walk there. Lions will not lurk along its course, nor any other ferocious beasts. There will be no other dangers. Only the redeemed will walk on it. Those who have been ransomed by the Lord will be returned. They will enter Jerusalem singing, crowned with everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be filled with joy and gladness. Amen.
Most gracious God, we are bound for Bethlehem, and we come with gratitude that you are always with us on our journey. Help us as we travel to stay on the path and keep us focused on the purpose of our mission. We confess that in the busyness of this season, we stray from the holy day and concentrate instead on the holiday. So we would ask that you would guide us. As we look at Christmas lights, might we be reminded of your light. Grant us the patience to pause in our task and bask in the promise of the star we follow. As we trim our trees, let us take time to share the treasured memories of family gatherings, so that it is your love that decorates our homes. As we shop for gifts, keep us mindful of the birthday we celebrate and the gift we are given in the manger. When we bake cookies and make candy, let us stir in forgiveness, serenity, peace, joy, and love, so that our presence reflect the gift of your presence. As we decorate and sell cookies this weekend, please infuse the cookies with the gift of your presence for each person who will consume one. We are bound for Bethlehem, O God. We each must answer as to whether there is room inside the inn of our hearts for your Son. Grant that it might be so. We thank you, Lord, as we've been praying for Alan Titus, that he is at home recovering well. We pray that you would be with Gina as new things have popped up in her diagnosis. We pray that you would continue to bring her joy, the fullness of your peace, as well as healing. We pray for the Irish family as they gather this week and as they deal with the death of the matriarch. It is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Let us sing together, "Go, Tell It on the Mountain."
Go, tell it on the mountain.
Our text this morning is found in the epistle of James, chapter 5, verses 7 through 10. I just have to say the joy that I see by looking back there. Dear brothers and sisters, be patient as you wait for the Lord's return. Consider the farmers who patiently wait for the rains in the fall and in the spring. They eagerly look for the valuable harvest to ripen. You too must be patient. Take courage, for the coming of the Lord is near. Don't grumble about each other, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. For look, the judge is standing at the door. For examples of patience in suffering, dear brothers and sisters, look at the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Juvenile impatience is so common that books and articles have been written to help parents combat it. At no time of the year is such impatience more on display than at Christmas. Our epistle text addresses the issue of impatience. The early believers were also impatient, and the Apostle James had some much needed advice. Kids are not good at waiting, but neither are adults for the most part. But let's stick with the kids for now. Waiting for the pediatrician at the doctor's office, waiting for their turn to play with their favorite toy, waiting with us at the DMV, or the RMV, whichever it is here, for our number to be called, waiting and asking from the back seat of the car, are we there yet? I think we will hear that as we travel back and forth, 8 or 9 hours one way. All these are painful experiences for children, but none is quite as difficult as waiting for Christmas to come. During the Christmas season, there's even more waiting than usual. Kids are asked to wait in long lines at stores as parents shop, for the cookies to cool before they can ice them. They wait in lines to have pictures taken with Santa. They muddle through the last few days of school, waiting for Christmas break to begin, and then suffer through delays at airports and in traffic before arriving at Grandma's house. All this is in addition to the most difficult wait of all, waiting for the big day to arrive. So how do you help children to be patient? How do you teach them patience? Experts have thoughts about this as normal. You might try modeling patience yourself. You could give kids some opportunities to talk about patience or impatience. You might also use timers when appropriate, or you could get the kids to do things that require more time and thus more patience. Teaching children patience is in itself a slow process that requires patience by the parent and grandparents, because we are born with impatience, it would seem. Each of us needs to be taught to wait. Can you imagine the impatience that it took from waiting from Genesis, when the Messiah is first promised, all the way through Malachi, and then Malachi stops. And this period that we call intertestamental, it's still time that the Messiah has not come. During this whole time, hope had centered on a coming Messiah whose advent would signify a new heart and a new spirit for anyone who would follow him. Sometimes we fail to appreciate these messianic prophecies because the identity of the Messiah is no longer a mystery to us. If this Christmas season needs an infusion of hope, consider the anticipation which with our faith fathers awaited the Messiah. Can we recapture the hope of Simeon, who occupied the temple daily and was promised that he would live to see the Christ being the Greek word and Messiah being the Hebrew word? When baby Jesus arrived at the temple, Simeon took him up in his arms and praised God. He said, "My eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and glory to your people Israel." How many of us show any impatience in waiting for Jesus? We're talking about this impatience because our text hints that just as children are impatient for Christmas to come, the biblical culture was impatient for the Messiah to come. The early church was growing impatient, waiting for Jesus to return as he had promised. Throughout Jesus' ministry, death, resurrection, and ascension, he had told his disciples that he would return for them, that they would one day live with him in the glorious kingdom of God. Jesus' first followers thought his return and the ushering in of this new day was imminent. With every passing day, they wondered, why the delay? The people were growing very impatient. The Epistle of James is a letter written to a church struggling with the wait. Repeatedly, he advises them to be patient. In this brief passage, James uses a form of the word patience four times. Be patient until the coming of the Lord, he writes, reminding the people for what they are waiting. It's no minor event. This is their hope. Jesus' return is worth the wait. Using the illustration of a farmer who patiently waits through the fall and winter for crops to arrive in the spring, James reminds the church that it might have to wait a while. Even casual gardeners know that there are seasons when it appears as though nothing is happening with the plants. Like the family experts who encourage parents to teach patience by growing plants with their children, James wants believers to use the patience that they have learned from farming as they wait for Jesus' return. James then encourages his church to hold on to their hope as they patiently wait. He knows how waiting can tempt us to take matters into our own hands in order to rush the results that we want. James advises the church not to give in or to give up, but to wait patiently for God's timing. Finally, James acknowledges that waiting can be painful. Using the prophets as an example, many prophets suffered emotional, psychological, and sometimes physical pain as they waited for the words God had given them to be fulfilled. James never sugarcoats how difficult the waiting can be, but still he reminds the church to be patient. You and I may not have the same expectations for the imminent return of Jesus as the early church did. We've had 2,000 years of experience of people saying the end is near without the end actually coming. In the last several years, we've heard predictions by televangelists, the ancient Mayans, politicians, books, and movies. Those dates have come and gone. The world has not come to an end. And here we are, still waiting patiently. We may not feel the urgency the early church felt about the return of Christ. We do know, however, that there have been times when we have prayed for Jesus to act in our lives, and he seemed to have delayed in giving a response in the hospital room, at the nursing home, or in the middle of the night when we're just wrestling with a problem. We have prayed for Jesus to bring healing for our family members, strength for our friends, or peace to our lives. We have cried out from the very depths of our heart, "Please, Jesus, don't be late." Through all, James reminds us to be patient, but the Bible's idea is patient is a little bit different from the way we think of patience today. WikiHow, a website that claims to be the place where one can learn how to do anything, offers tips and advice on a wide variety of topics. At wikihow.com, you can learn how to alleviate back pain, breed canaries, write a screenplay. A section of the website titled Christmas for Kids contains articles on how to write a letter to Santa, snoop for your Christmas presents without your parents finding out, and how to draw baby Jesus. One story even gives advice on how to wait for Christmas morning. Many of the suggestions WikiHow gives involve being distracted. They recommend tiring yourself out before going to bed on Christmas Eve, reading a book, listening to music. Maybe that's why we love to listen to Christmas music, because it takes our mind out of the waiting. Making lists, writing in a journal. The idea is to occupy your mind with something. If you focus on something other than the day to come and try to do things as you do them on every other day, the hours will pass more quickly. Some of us don't have to worry about filling our time. We just need more time to get what we're doing done. Other suggestions, however, encourage the children to do just the opposite. Rather than trying to forget about the fact that Christmas is coming, they're advised to enter more fully into the Christmas season. These ideas include helping mom and dad with Christmas preparations like wrapping gifts, decorating, baking, and getting Santa's snacks ready. These activities not only pass the time, but they involve the child in the preparation. They allow kids to enter into the day to come. It's not Christmas yet, but we remember that Christmas is coming by doing Christmas things today. This is a type of patience James teaches the early church. He doesn't tell them to wait passively. He distracts them while they pass the time until Jesus returns. Instead, he calls the church to enter into the day of the coming of the kingdom of God by living kingdom lives today. The examples James gives of kingdom living are simple ones. Don't grumble about one another. No. Don't complain about your sisters and brothers. Be patient by loving and caring for another. And now this screen. Advent is often thought of as a countdown to Christmas. We light the candles of Advent wreath each Sunday, marking how the celebration of the arrival of light of the world draws near. A brief insertion to all who remember that this Advent season is a time to prepare our hearts and our world to receive Jesus. We remember in this season that we are to be the light of the world. All who welcome Jesus are a light shining in the darkness. Now, we cannot penetrate every expression of darkness, fear, hatred, evil, but what we can do is light. As light bulbs, which we have new LED light bulbs in all of our windows, is make sure that we stay screwed in. And then that we're plugged in, turned on, shining with all the wattage that has been given to us. You don't all have to shine equally, but shine with the wattage that you have been given. And this was from a friend of mine. Cover my light with a basket. No, I'm going to let it shine. Parents purchase Advent calendars for their homes that serve as timers for the children, showing just how many sleeps there are until Christmas. Advent is a time of waiting and preparing for Jesus. Jesus' story is not over. We live between Jesus ushering in the kingdom of God and it arriving in the fullness when he returns. As we prepare to celebrate the glorious gift of Jesus coming to us on the first Christmas morning, wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger, we also remember that we are called to wait patiently and prepare for the coming of Jesus again. Sometimes the wait is for Jesus' healing hand to arrive in the brokenness of our lives. In these times, James is once again relevant. Be patient, he writes, and we strive to live as those who have already been made whole. At other times, we wait for Jesus to return and make the world what it was intended to be, a reflection of God, of his grace and his love. Again, the advice of James returns to us. Be patient and seek to live as those who are already citizens of the kingdom of God. Advent is a time for patiently waiting, a time to prepare, a time to remember. During the season, we cry out with our children, please, Christmas, don't be late. In patience, we enter into the presence of Christ with us every day, living as though the return has already happened. Patience is not grumbling about our brothers and sisters because we know that there is a better day to come. Patience is trusting that our struggle is in Jesus' hands, even when we cannot see what the outcome will be. Patience is living today as if Christmas has already come, as if Jesus has already returned. And so we patiently wait and prepare and say, Jesus, please don't be late. Let us pray. O Lord our God, may we hope fervently for your advent. We long to see you. Help us recapture the awe that we had as young children. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now let us get into singing this song, He Came Down.
Thank you.
joyful always.
Pray continually.
Give thanks in all circumstances.
For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Amen.